Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. In this video, I'll be explaining about temperature inversion. Temperature inversion is a phenomenon in which a colder air mass is overlain by a warmer air mass, which is in contrast to normal conditions where a warmer air mass is overlain by a colder air mass. So why do we have a warmer air mass which is at lower layers of atmosphere during normal conditions? We know that Earth has atmosphere, and as we move away from Earth, the pressure decreases because of rarefaction of atmosphere. Likewise, as we move towards the surface, we have greater atmospheric pressure because of compression offered by the upper layers. So this compressive force increases the temperature of the bottom layers. And one more important reason is the Earth's terrestrial radiation. So Earth receives sun's energy in the form of ultraviolet radiation during daytime, and it emits back this radiation in the form of infrared radiation or terrestrial radiation during nights. So this emitted radiation is mostly absorbed by greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, water vapor, etc. And as these gases are abundantly present very close to the surface, the absorption is greater, and hence the temperature at the surface is very high. So as we move upwards, the density of air decreases, as well as the concentration of greenhouse gases also decreases. As a result, the temperature keeps falling as we move upwards, and this condition is called as lapse rate. So if you look at the temperature profile of troposphere, we can see how temperature falls with increase in height. So this is called as lapse rate. I've given a detailed account about adiabatic lapse rate in my previous videos. So how does this temperature profile change during the conditions of temperature inversion? We can see that we have a colder layer at the bottom, that is usually temperature falling. And suddenly we have increase in temperature due to the presence of warmer layers. So the temperature profile again falls because of fall in temperature. We can see this will be the total variation in temperature profile. We can see this region has a completely different profile because of presence of warmer air mass between two colder air masses. So we can say that a warmer air mass is sandwiched between a colder air mass at the bottom and another colder air mass at the top. So this is the usual condition of temperature inversion. We can see the temperature profile is comparatively a little different because of temperature inversion. So this is how temperature inversion looks. This is called as Intermountain Valley temperature inversion, about which we'll be studying in detail. So this is the normal condition where we have warmer layers at the bottom followed by colder layers and much colder layers as we move upwards. And in the other case, that is in the temperature inversion situation, we have a colder layer and a warmer layer, and again a colder layer, that is a warmer layer being sandwiched between two colder layers. So what are the ideal conditions for temperature inversion? There are three important conditions. One is longer nights, clear skies, and calm and stable air. So for the temperature inversion to occur, we usually need to have great loss of heat then heat gained. That is, the heat loss must be greater than the amount of heat gained, and this needs to be a constant process for a very long period of time. So long nights mainly facilitate in Earth's terrestrial radiation. As a result, the heat loss is greater, which will aid in temperature inversion. And also we have clear skies which won't interrupt this loss of radiation, and hence the amount of heat lost is greater, which will also facilitate temperature inversion. And we need to have calm and stable air so that these layers doesn't get mixed, so that there is no disturbance and these layers remain constant for a very long time, giving rise to the condition of temperature inversion. So now we'll see how long nights, clear skies, and calm air aid in temperature inversion. So if you see this figure, I've previously explained about mountain breeze and valley breeze in my previous video. So temperature inversion is closely related to this phenomena of mountain breeze and valley breeze, except that here the mountain breeze dominates the valley breeze. So here during daytimes, we have between intermountain valleys, that is in the intermountain valleys, we have the air moving towards the mountain slopes because of the vacuum created by the warm air which is rising towards the upper layers. So this happens during daytime. The exact opposite happens during nights, as there is great amount of heat lost. The air becomes denser and it falls back to the valley. So this is how a temporary kind of temperature inversion is achieved during night time. But again, in the night, the condition changes as this cold air flows upwards and the warm air replaces the valley region. So this is normal conditions. So temperature inversion doesn't last for long, it only lasts for a night. But this kind of situation usually happens in tropical regions where heat gained is much greater than heat lost. But if you take the condition of temperate and higher latitude regions, we have greater loss of heat than greater heat gained. So in such cases, the daytime influence is lower, that is, this upliftment of air is considerably lower, and hence the valley bottom sustains this colder air mass. So this sustaining of colder air mass creates a perpetual layer of colder air mass, creating a temperature inversion like situation. So how does this situation occur? We see that during nights there is greater amount of heat lost, so the parcel of air becomes denser due to prolonged contact with this surface of the mountain, and as it gets cold and it becomes dense and slips towards the downslope of the mountains, and it gets accumulated in this valley. So here we have a comparatively colder air mass because of in contact with the mountain, which is losing great amount of heat. During daytime, as these regions are in temperate and higher latitudes, usually the amount of sunlight received is much lower, and also the sun's rays will be very slant. So this slant rays doesn't have great influence. And also if the mountain is snow capped, then there will be greater albedo and the gaining of heat is completely negligible. As a result, this cold air mass which was formed during nights will keep on improving over successive periods, and hence the cold air mass keeps on strengthening. So there is no complete cycle of valley and mountain breeze. There is only one breeze, that is mountain breeze. So this accumulation of mountain breeze creates a temperature inversion like situation. So this kind of mountain breeze which is created in intermountain valleys is quite significant. It is constant for a very long time, so it doesn't get disturbed because of the presence of mountains and also lesser vertical and horizontal air mixing. So the temperature inversion in intermountain valleys is very prominent. So we can see this figure how a temperature inversion occurs. But usually in the above layers we see a certain amount of heat which is observed because of farness from the mountain slopes which are very cold. So this layer is comparatively warmer, whereas the bottom layers are comparatively much colder. So this is the example, a warmer layer being sandwiched between two colder layers. Let us now look at types of temperature inversion. Till now what we have talked is a kind of advectional temperature inversion, about which I'll be giving telling about that in next slides. Now let us look at the first type, which is called as surface temperature inversion or ground inversion. This normally occurs in polar regions and regions where the climate is very cold. Due to prolonged contact of air mass with the lower surfaces, usually a cold air mass is established on the surface, followed by a warm air mass. And then usually we have in upper layers, we have cold air mass because of lapse rate. So this is a situation of temperature inversion. And this kind of situation doesn't stay for long, as once the sun rises, this thing changes as the ground becomes comparatively warmer, and hence this layer of air is disturbed. And also as these regions are very flat, we can see there is greater influence of vertical and horizontal air movements, and hence it gets completely disturbed during daytimes. So this kind of temperature inversion occurs only during night, whereas during daytime it is completely destroyed. This is a very temporary kind of temperature inversion. And another kind of inversion is called as advectional type of temperature inversion, which is seen in frontogenesis. Frontogenesis, or we can say front formation, is a situation where a warmer air mass is uplifted due to the intrusion of colder air mass. So we'll study this in detail while dealing with fronts, that is future topics. So now we'll just look at how this leads to temperature inversion. We can see that this colder air mass is rushing towards this layer which has total warmer air mass. So when this colder air mass pushes this warmer air mass, usually warmer air mass is lighter, and hence it completely gets uplifted, which results in formation of cumulonimbus clouds due to accumulation of water vapor in the form of condensation, and it forms huge amount of rain in this region. So this region of contact between warm and cold air mass is called as a front. So this is a kind of temperature inversion which is not a temporary one. This is not a permanent one. It is only a temporary one. So this is called as advectional type advectional type of temperature inversion. And the other one is upper surface temperature inversion or subsidence inversion. So this occurs when there is subsidence of air. Subsidence usually occurs in polar regions where there is high pressure zone at the poles. And we have another zone near the equator in the subtropical high pressure cells where we have subsidence in both the hemispheres, about 25 to 35 degrees north and south. And we have in polar regions where there is subsidence. So this subsidence of air, that is when air falls to the ground after losing all its moisture, is subjected to greater atmospheric pressure as it falls to the bottom layers because of greater pressure at the bottom layers. And this pressure increases the temperature of this air mass. And at certain levels, this air mass is comparatively warmer than the bottom layers. So this creates a temperature inversion-like situation. So this mainly occurs in the subsidence regions like subtropical high pressure zones and polar highs. Again, this is also not very significant. But what we have talked about, air drainage type of temperature inversion, previously I have said it advectional type, but this is not advectional type, it is air drainage type. So air drainage type is nothing but intermountain valley temperature inversion. So I've explained in detail about how intermountain valley temperature inversion occurs. So this is very significant one, as the temperature inversion here is prolonged or stays for a very long time. That is, the bottom layers remain cold for a very, very long time, and it is more pronounced in winters. So what are the most important point is implications of temperature inversion. So what are the implications of temperature inversion? The first thing is it lowers visibility due to accumulation of fog. As we have seen that due to lower temperatures, usually air is dense, and as it falls to the valley, the moisture content slightly condenses. So it doesn't condense to an extent to form rains. And at the same time, the condensation is not so low to keep the visibility good. So in such a condition, we have fog and the visibility is comparatively very low. And we have very less rainfall. This is because we don't have convection when there is a kind of temperature inversion situation. That is, we have seen that we have a colder air mass followed by a warmer air mass, and then we have comparatively a colder air mass. Here the convection doesn't occur. We have seen how convection occurs in my previous videos. So when there is no convection, there is no condensation of water vapor to form rains. So there is no cloud formation at the upper layers. So usually clouds, we need to have cumulonimbus or nimbostratus clouds which give rainfall. Other than this, clouds which are formed at the layers at the very surface of the earth are called as fog. So they don't bring any rain. They create a desiccating effect, that is, they don't allow condensation, and hence there will be no rain. So this is very important. Intermountain valleys receive less rainfall because of very stable conditions. Trees along the lower slopes are bitten by frost, again as due to successive accumulation of colder air. Usually these regions are very, very cold, so the trees here are bitten by frost. So whereas at higher levels we have layers which are free of frost, and hence these layers support a growth of vegetation. Usually we have good vegetation at the bottom also, but still there is frost, the presence of frost and very cold climate, which to an extent hinders the growth of vegetation. And air pollutants doesn't get dispersed. This is very important because there is no movement of air. All we see is subsidence of air along this slope. So this air keeps on accumulating in the region, so it doesn't get outer to external environment quickly. And this accumulation gives rise to constant accumulation of pollutants like smoke, dust, etc. So this kind of situation creates a huge dense air pollution. And then houses and farms are present on the mountain slopes rather than at the valleys. We have seen that at valleys we have lower visibility and also rainfall is low, and most of the surface is bitten by frost for a long period of time, and hence people settle along the slopes rather than at the valley bottom. The best example for this kind of situation is seen in India and Brazil. In Brazil, we see about coffee growers who usually settle along the slopes, and the valleys are left forested. So there are no settlements in the valley regions. The same situation is in Himalayas, where the apple growers avoid lower slopes. So again, Himalayas, though they are in tropical or near temperate regions, but still because of their huge mountains, the valleys receive little sunlight, and hence there is greater loss of heat than gained, and temperature inversion is very strong. So these are the implications of temperature inversion. So this was a question asked in 2013 mains. What do you understand by phenomena of temperature inversion in meteorology, and how does it affect weather and habitats of place? So this is the direct answer along with the explanation. So this is all about temperature inversion. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to my channel. I'll be posting more videos.